welcome and thank you for joining us. The roadshow, as we call it, is something we had done pre-COVID in person, and now, and like many things, we've switched to virtual. But I think this is going to be a really useful tool for folks to get a broad understanding of our Grants Gateway process, and then be able to ask individual questions. Again, I know there's folks who might be interested in more than one outcome, and we will certainly try to accommodate your questions as much as we can through this presentation. I am going to turn down the volume because people are still joining, so I keep getting little things on my end. I'm just going to turn it down. And then if you have any issues hearing me, let me know. But just wanted to do, if we could, Christine, if you could actually move to, if you could go down, I should have done this earlier. This is our agenda. Thank you. This is what we'll be going through. So I'm just going to give a brief overview of what Grants Gateway is and why we do our application process this way. And then we'll get into detail about each one of the outcomes, as Sasha explained. At the end of that, we will talk a little bit about the application process, which is pretty similar for each outcome. There are a few differences, which can be discussed in fuller detail in those breakout sessions. And then lastly, we will put you into the breakout rooms that you chose during registration. Next slide, please. And can you just, Christine, move down to the next slide, and we'll come back to this one. Thank you. So I think it's really important for folks to understand why we do this. So what you're looking at here is really the mission of Chesapeake and Coastal Service. Our Grants Gateway was created to streamline the grant application process that we have for government, non-government organizations, and academic institutions. And it was really to provide a one-stop location for communities who seek technical and financial support for projects that help foster these three main areas that we focus on, which is healthy ecosystems and communities, economies, and communities resilient in the face of climate change. So this is really important to understand, you know, kind of the breadth of what Chesapeake Coastal Service does, but then why we created Grants Gateway. So we had multiple grant programs, and we really wanted to provide an easier opportunity for not only the applicant to apply for funding, but also internally for us to work together and across different programs to see if we could integrate and collaborate on projects. So you can go bump back up, Christine, thanks. Sorry. So there you go. Basically what I just said, what is Grants Gateway? So if you've never been on our portal, it is an application online portal. It's a grant application for multiple outcomes. And, you know, since it launched, I think it's been, I want to say maybe 4 or 5 years. We've really had a lot of good feedback on the process and, you know, ability for folks to not have to do multiple processes, or even folks who are unsure of what outcome their project actually fits in. It allows them to enter it, and then we on the back end can work together across the unit to figure out the best funding source or outcome for that project. You will see here, and we'll probably post it multiple times, where you can find the Grants Gateway on our website. I will be the first to admit that the department's website can get a little clunky. We've worked very hard to streamline that as well. But if you go on to the Chesapeake and Coastal Service main page, there are some tabs along the top, and one of them is funding, and you can navigate to the Grants Gateway that way as well. You know, we will talk more in depth after I'm done here about each specific outcome, but just in general, what we define as an outcome, they're really multiple funding programs that look at specific natural resources results. So the funding can come from state or federal funding. We have the Chesapeake and Atlantic Coastal Based Trust Fund, which is state funding. We have the Waterway Improvement Fund. And we also have federal funding from both NOAA and EPA. So a lot of different funding sources go into these different outcomes. And then finally, this is probably what you're going to want to pay most attention to as you work through this are those important dates. Now, we try to keep these consistent from year to year. You know, we say Grants Gateway comes out in July. It does, the RFP does open in July. The date varies somewhat, and that's more internally due to communications and approval from State House and things like that. So we try to get it open as early in July as possible, but usually early mid till July is when it opens. And this year it will be closing on December 14th. So there's a good amount of time to work on proposals and work with staff. You'll see I grayed out two dates there. One was the opening, since we're already in the middle of the process, and the second one is the closing of the Waterway Improvement Fund. So that has a shorter time frame than the other outcomes. That's pretty consistent, and that's due to the fact that their project list does get approved on a different timeline than ours does. So they do have a smaller window for applications. However, the opening is the same as all the other outcomes. So this year, the key date you want to look at there is that December 14th deadline. Then what happens after you submit your grant? Well, we take a few months to look at those applications, put them together. Lots of peer review goes into it. And we come up with our priority list, which then gets reviewed through both our, through the department as well as through the State House, and awards are announced in, we try to do late May, early June, and then we start the process all over again in July. So it's really a year-long process for us. We're doing this constantly. it's a good way for us to do all of these programs at once and sync everything up. And we hope it's useful for you, the applicant, as well. And I'll just pause right there for a second. See if we had any pressing questions before we move on to the outcomes. No, and I apologize. I do have my window open, and I think that a garbage truck just went by, so I apologize if that messed up any of the recording, but that's really all I wanted to go through as far as an introduction. And again, we will get into more details on outcomes, and we can discuss a little bit more about the application process on the tail end. So thank you. So yeah, so now we're up to section outcome one, and I think I'll turn it over to Dana Reese, who will take you through that one.
Thanks, Kristen. Next slide, please, Christine. Thank you. Well, good morning. My name is Dana Reese, and I get to kick us off here with Outcome 1. Outcome 1 is largely funded through the Chesapeake and Atlantic Coastal Based Trust Fund, or Trust Fund for short. And through legislation, our main goal is to reduce the nutrients and sediment from entering the bay by implementing some cost-effective projects. And in addition to this, we are also interested in targeting co-benefits to promote a more holistic approach to projects. So as you can see, government-affiliated and non-governmental organizations are able to apply. Communities are encouraged to work with watershed groups or other experienced environmental nonprofits. And any for-profit aggregators that are interested in the pay-for-success model are encouraged to partner with a local jurisdiction or nonprofit as the applicant at this time. So as Kristen discussed already, the solicitation is open now and will close on December 14th. Do not wait until the last minute to enter your proposal, because, you know, at 8 p.m. on December 14th, no one's going to be around. So, and also, as far as site visits go, we would hope that you would have your site visits completed or requested at least by the end of November. So keep that in mind, please. As you can see here, we have a few project types that are funded through the trust fund, but I'd like to highlight the trees and the wetlands here. They are very hot, hot project types right now. So please bring those to us. They are usually, they end up being the most cost-effective projects that come in. And they also have great co-benefits such as habitat creation and carbon sequestration. And let's see, the request, we do have a minimum of a $500,000 request per grant. If you do have something, a project or a group of projects that comes in lower than that, no worries, just reach out to us and let us know. We just want to make sure that we are not competing with other grant sources. Next slide, please, Christine. Thank you. So what makes your project competitive? We do look at nutrient reductions and the cost per pound. I'm able to get into kind of the calculation that we do for that in our breakout session. And so those co-benefits that I was talking about that I mentioned earlier, you know, include some of these listed here, but also we're looking at local employment opportunities, improvement to public recreation, and projects that benefit things like SAVA, submerged aquatic vegetation, or oysters. You also find that projects that are further along in design or projects that are closer to being construction ready tend to be chosen for awards, and projects that benefit all over one are encouraged. And finally, a note on long-term sustainability. This is not a set it and forget it fund. We don't want you to implement a project and then walk away. We are looking for a project oversight. We're looking for champions to help with your project longevity and, you know, maintenance plans with buy-in. These grants are a lot of money, and so we want to be sure that we are making sound investments. Next slide, please, Christine. Thank you. I wanted to stress that you should get us involved early. We highly recommend site visits, especially for stream restorations, because it's really important to recognize any potential trade-offs early, things like tree loss or loss of existing in-stream habitat. We can get help from fisheries and other expertise early. We can get them involved early so that it's going to save you time and pain later in permitting. I'd be happy to answer more specific questions about Outcome One, the trust fund, in our breakout session. And now I will turn it over to the folks in Outcome Two. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dana. Good morning, everyone. This is Sasha Land. I am one of the project managers for Outcome 2, and the others will introduce themselves as we go along. I share the coastal side with Kate Vogel. But Outcome 2 is really to build community resilience to flood risk. And so when we talk about flood risk, we're talking both coastal, so tidally influenced flood risk, as well as precipitation-based. And ours, Outcome is focused on that understanding and planning aspect. So we are not implementing the projects, but we're getting you up to the point of implementation. We have a fund source that comes from two different federal entities, one being NOAA and the other EPA. So because of that, our applicants can be municipal or county governments. And we encourage them to partner with NGOs and other community partners as well. You can request the amount up to $125,000, though I will say that typically we fund projects in the $60,000 to, let's say, $80,000 range. So if you want to switch to the next slide. So specifically on the coastal side, we have a number of different types of projects that we have funded over the years. The first one.
Why can I not hear? Oh, I know why.
The first one is looking at community benefits. So we do long-term kind of strategic visioning. Other components that we have funded, and this one's important because this legislative mandate is coming up in 2025. So we also have funded nuisance flood plans. This funding is available next fall, starting in fall of 2024. So if you're a community that is updating or needs to update your flood plan, which is every 5 years, this cycle would be the time to apply for that. We also fund more. So if those are two very broad, either county or municipal type plans, but we also will fund at a neighborhood level. So if you have a neighborhood or a smaller region within your community that is experiencing flood impacts, you can apply for funding to look at kind of those smaller regions. But really, I want to emphasize, no matter what type of planning process that you do, we are looking to kind of for these plans to serve as a foundation to kind of understand the impacts, to prioritize different, to both identify and prioritize areas, but we really want these to be a springboard leading to implementation projects, and whether that's through an outcome one project, though more likely it'll be through outcome two or other funding mechanisms that are outside of DNR. So we really have that emphasis on planning to implementation. And with that, I will turn it over to Ari, who will talk about the precipitation-based planning.
Hey, everyone. My name is Ari Engelberg, and I work on both Outcome 1 and 2, but today I'm helping out with Outcome 2. So on the inland planning side for Outcome 2, funding can go towards a variety of projects. And these efforts should help an applicant plan for and address current and anticipated future issues associated with riverine and or pluvial flooding. Some past projects that have included tasks such as surveying existing stormwater infrastructure, modeling the performance of that stormwater infrastructure under current and future rainfall events, and identifying potential BMP opportunities to mitigate flooding. There are a number of resources available to support these planning efforts and many engineering firms that specialize in helping communities with those plans. DNR also actually recently financed a community guide to assessing non-tidal flood impacts in Maryland, which can be found at the following URL, which I'm going to paste in the IM for folks to reference. And that's like a resource that's designed to help applicants to outcome to in inland settings. So, you know, hopefully that'll be useful for folks as well. Next slide, please, Christian. Thank you. So across both the inland and coastal Outcome 2 projects, there are a handful of application elements which will help make your proposal more successful. Some of these include referencing MyCoast to help document the impacts of flooding in your community. MyCoast is a really valuable tool which has an array of capabilities, ranging from being able to upload photos of flooding with your phone, including detailed descriptions, to downloading MyCoast data to inform your planning efforts. And Kate Vogel, who's here with us today, can provide a much more detailed support for you if you have questions on MyCoast. We also strongly encourage applicants to provide letters of support. Being really clear in how your application, just like Sasha was mentioning, is gonna not just be about planning and design, but really inform on the ground implementation as well. And working closely in collaboration with community members as well. This should really be ideally be a collaborative project that's going to engage many members of your communities. Kate, Sasha, and I are going to be available in the Outcome 2 breakout room to help answer any questions that you may have. Thanks very much for your time.
So now we'll turn it over to Nicole, who will go through the Outcome 3.
Thanks, Sasha. Hi, everyone. My name is Nicole Carlozzo, and I am the point of contact for Outcome 3. Outcome 3 supports design and construction projects that address erosion and flooding. And we have a focus for working in communities and on public lands. And some of the major differences between outcome one and outcome three include that outcome three does support design of restoration projects. And we also focus on water quantity. So how water is impacting communities in the form of waves or flooding. So we're very much focused on addressing erosion and flood impacts. Local governments and nonprofits can apply for funding. And if you have questions about nonprofit eligibility, please reach out to me and I can provide more details on those requirements. We again fund design and construction. Design awards are typically up to $100,000. We do not have a maximum for construction requests, but our projects typically fall between $200,000 for a smaller scale project to about $1.5 million for a larger scale project. So please reach out to me to discuss any larger scale projects that exceed these amounts. And like the other outcomes, these awards are reimbursable and do require quarterly reports from the applicant. And these photos here just show an example project of a living shoreline that was completed in Somerset County, about 1,100 linear feet. And I can provide more details on this project in the breakout if folks are interested in some of that information. Next slide, please. So for this outcome, nature-based projects are eligible, which means that projects must have a habitat element. And some examples include wetland or dune restoration, tree planting, oyster reefs, and living shorelines. We also can support stormwater projects. So any projects that are nature-based that address rain-induced flooding are eligible. So this could include bioretention or rain garden projects, stream restoration, or regenerative stormwater conveyance systems. And the photos on the slide here are an example of a living shoreline and regenerative stormwater conveyance system project that were completed at a site in Anne Arundel County. We do encourage folks with innovative project ideas to reach out to me to talk with me about those innovative ideas and projects, and we encourage you to apply through outcome three. Proposals for this outcome do need to showcase how the project reduces risk to some form of infrastructure, whether it's a road or homes, public park, public access area. Successful applicants are going to be quantifying in their proposals the number of people that benefit from the project and the types of infrastructure or structures that benefit from the project. And some of the required attachments are listed on the bottom of this slide, and I can go over more details on that in the breakout group for any of those requirements. And I also do want to mention that this outcome distributes both state funding and federal funding. And for state projects, they all go before the Board of Public Works. Federally funded projects are reviewed by our federal partner, NOAA. Some of the projects submitted under this outcome will be submitted to our federal partners for competitive funding. So it's really important in your application to provide a clear timeline of your project so that we can best fit the project with the appropriate funding source. Next slide, please. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about what makes a competitive proposal for outcome three. We do prioritize projects with public access or projects on public lands. And we are looking for projects that have a direct connection to a local county or municipality plan. For example, a nuisance flood plan or any plan that may be developed through outcome two or through another planning effort. Again, this outcome is focused on water quantity, not water quality. And so projects are more often associated with climate resilience or hazard mitigation. And then for non-government applicants, you will be required to submit a letter of support from your local government. And I really recommend that within those letters, the local government entity talk a little bit about those connections with local planning. Match is not required for this outcome, but we do strongly encourage it for larger scale implementation projects or projects that are being proposed in closed communities. And one way to increase cost effectiveness is through the use of dredge material in your project. And we have department staff that you can reach out to about that. So come talk to me in the Outcome 3 breakout if you're interested in learning more about that. Projects should also provide community-wide benefits, and the applicant should demonstrate readiness for the proposed project phase. So for a design project, this means having a concept or concept level or greater design available and an RFP process or contractor identified. And for construction projects, this means having a 100% designed and permitted project and a maintenance and monitoring plan in place. And we also look for proof of community buy-in and support for construction-ready projects. Projects should be incorporated climate change data into the design, and I can talk with you more about that in the breakout if you have questions. And we do require community meetings as part of these projects. And then lastly, we do screen these projects through a number of data sets. The state's coastal resiliency assessment is used for coastal projects, and the Maryland Environmental Justice Screen, EJ Screen, is used for all projects. We do not use the data sets to evaluate eligibility, but the data are considered in decision making. So I can talk more about that in the breakout if there are questions. And I'm going to pass it on to the Outcome 4 rep, Jen. Thank you.
Thanks, Nicole. Hi, everyone. I'm Jen Wolf. I'm the project manager for Outcome 4, which is our outdoor learning component or outdoor learning outcome. Its main goal is to improve student ability to take action benefiting the Chesapeake Bay, our coastal ecosystems, through various things like professional development, curriculum expansion, outdoor learning experiences. And our ultimate goal is stewardship, continued stewardship. So who can apply? School systems, non-government organizations, universities, different entities apply, or agencies apply, or organizations apply every year. It is a reimbursable grant. That's something to say up front. Like most of these, that's something really important to consider. If you can switch to the second slide, please. This outcome, just to let you know, is an EPA-funded outcome. It's through the Chesapeake Bay Implementation Grant. So it's about, we'll get to that in the next slide, but the same RFP dates for the Grants Gateway. And we're really interested in outdoor environmental experiences for K-12. It's not that you can't have an indoor piece or that indoor learning is not a part of it, but the outdoor experiences are really what we're looking to connect students and youth with and communities with. So next slide, please. So the request is up to 100,000. That's for the year. We do get some requests for the full amount. Typically, we're hoping that's pretty much launching a sustainable program that will be continued and somehow funded continuously moving forward. We're hoping that those experiences can be met by youth and students each year, getting more and more students outside. So with things like professional development and even habitat restoration. So some of that with the Department of Natural Resources is really, it's a nice cohesion if we have some restoration projects that also have an education component or education programs that have some sort of restoration piece. And whether that's through tree plantings, buffer restoration on school grounds or in the community, some do actual shoreline restoration. There's different things that you can do. We have a wild rice program in a few counties, so that's something that's a match between what's happening in our schools and what's happening through actual restoration. And so what makes a competitive grant for us is to incorporate student, youth, or community voice. So we've had some programs and some projects that have actually brought students into the actual project, thinking and brainstorming ahead of time, community members involved. That's gone a long way with some of the applicants. Certainly looking through the lens of diversity, equity, inclusion, driving the programming, looking at historically underserved communities and students and youth that have even ecosystems that have been underrepresented, and newly, but not newly, with a focus on climate and environmental justice, always through the lens of that when you're thinking about your programming. I can be reached at the email there. We also have office hours that were discussed. You can find that through the link in the webinar here, and we can talk further if you want to discuss your project and anything that you're thinking coming forward. I see some things coming through the chat. The track two is a separate, I don't think we have her here today, but that's a marine debris component. So that's something separate. It's under outcome four, but it's actually a separate track. You're right. So again, a reimbursable grant. Something that we have talked about in terms of formatting for outdoor learning is the MeWe, the Meaningful Watershed Educational Experience. That is a great solid model, but it doesn't have to be the only model that you present for your programming. We have 24 school districts, just to let you know. So it's a competitive grant in that sense, everybody working with different schools, school districts. We have a wide range of projects. Typically, we get asked between, I want to say, 25 and 50,000 is a typical ask, but you can certainly, some projects do come in at the full 100,000. No match required, like some of the other outcomes. You can certainly include that if you want to show that that's happening for you, but not necessary. And that's about it for outcome four. If you have any questions, you can certainly email me on the back end of this. Thank you.
Hi, good morning. My name is Alice Scanlon, and I'm the program administrator in the Center for Waterway Improvement and Infrastructure. And I'm going to speak briefly about Outcome 5, the Waterway Improvement Fund. As Kristen mentioned, our deadline has already passed on September 18th. However, I think it's important to mention some of the things that we look for when we get applications and how we review them, and also what kind of projects are eligible. Just to speak a little bit about the program. The Waterway Improvement Fund grant program was established in 1966. The revenue is derived primarily from a 5% excise tax that is charged when you purchase and title a boat in the state of Maryland. And also a small portion of the motor fuel tax is also part of the revenue of the Waterway Improvement Fund. So it is a user pay, user benefit program. We've provided more than $366 million with a mandated focus on the benefit to the motorized boating public. Our grants are available for local governments, municipalities, the counties, state, and federal government entities. And every year we accept the applications when Grants Gateway opens in mid-July, typically. Through mid-September. Our contacts, Carla Fleming is our director. I had updated this previously, I guess it just didn't make it. Isaac Wilding is our dredging coordinator. I manage the central and western region, as well as all of the state-owned facilities, the grants that we provide to the state through DNR for state parks, boating projects. Matt Negley is our eastern region contact. He manages Kent County all the way down to Worcester, Somerset County. And Celeste Anderson is the southern region, which is the west side of the bay, Anne Arundel, Prince George's, and south. Next slide, please. So our eligible projects include public marinas, public boat ramps. In the previous page, you saw a picture of a boat ramp that was just recently completed this year, Merritt Point Park in Dundalk, and the two-lane boat ramp with a floating dock. That boat ramp was originally constructed in the early 70s, and it was in pretty bad shape. That is a brand new facility. They did a great job, including the floating dock. It's ADA accessible. We're encouraging the local governments when they're doing boat ramp construction to put in floating docks if possible. It helps to address higher than normal high tide and just makes it easier for getting in and out of the boats. The dredging of navigable channels, dredge material placement sites, it's important to have those already in place, or if it's possible to do beneficial use, as Nicole mentioned, that is something else that we work together with them on. Also the acquisition of rescue vessels, fireboats, motors and trailers. Again, it's to address any boater needs when they're out on the water and safety concerns. So what makes a really strong application is giving us a lot of details. It's important to answer all of the questions in the application because we look at each of those, and it's all part of the review and the scoring of the application. Provide as many details as possible. What is the current condition of the facility? What is your proposed work that you want to do? Also the readiness to proceed. Is it a project where design is complete? Have you received a grant from us previously for design? If so, maybe you're asking for additional funding for construction. The number of boaters who will benefit from the project, does it enhance the public access? And also the safety concerns, which I touched on just a little bit. Are there channels that have become very shallow, making it difficult for boaters to get in and out? Deteriorated bulkheads, failing bulkheads. All of these are critical to maintaining and ensuring a safe public boating facility. You can get more information at DNR's website under boating, and then you select grants, and we have a lot more information in there. In our Waterway Improvement Fund manual, information about what type of funding you can get. Is it a matching? Is it a project that would require a matching grant? Is it something that could be 100% funded? There's just a lot more information, how we score our projects. All of that information is in the Waterway Improvement Fund manual, which you can find on DNR's website. Again, this was a very brief overview on our Waterway Improvement Fund, but the application deadline has passed, but hopefully this will be helpful next year if you're considering submitting an application for our funding.
Sorry, I was on mute. Hi, everybody. My name is Wes Gould. I am the program manager for the Shoreline Erosion Control Program here in CCS, which oddly enough, the loan program sometimes doesn't generate as much interest as some of the grants you just heard about. But nonetheless, it's a great tool to get some of these projects funded. So a bit of history on the program. It was established in the 1960s. With the purpose of providing technical and financial assistance to waterfront property owners throughout the state who are experiencing erosion. Today, the interest-free loan program is only able to fund nature-based living shoreline projects. As of the passage of the Living Shoreline Act of 2008, which basically requires property owners to look to do some sort of marsh creation project first, before installing a bulkhead or a revetment. So those the bulkheads and revetments are not eligible for this funding source, so I wanted to be clear on that. We get a lot of questions about that. The loan program's new to Grants Gateway this year to the platform. And another thing to note that's a little bit new this year is we've opened up the solicitation to single private property owners. So we are able to fund both design and construction of living shoreline projects. Eligible applicants, you can see the list there. We can fund private property owners, NGOs, community organizations, and local governments. And this year we've got about $800,000 allocated towards the solicitation, which is subject to change in future years. So site requests we require as part of the application, and that can be made. We've got a link on our website, a green button at the top of the page. And along with that, you can have somebody from our CHOP come out and evaluate your shoreline, give you some recommended solutions, and connect you with a local network of folks, whether that be your local regulator, your local watershed organization, contractors. We can kind of connect you with that group of folks that can take your project from concept to reality. Next page, Christine. So here are a few criteria that we look for in a competitive proposal. As you might want to think about as you're developing one, we look at funding comprehensive projects that demonstrate a clear project need, that are cost effective in nature, have a maintenance plan in place, and provide opportunities for ecological uplift. Loan terms range anywhere from 5 to 20 years, depending on the project type. Whether that be a traditional sill or headland breakwater, those terms may vary a bit. And we do this through two different funding mechanisms. So if it's a county-owned property or a community organization, that would be done through a special taxing district, which is part of that process. You'd get a petition signed, acquire about 75%, at least 75% of support for those within that taxing boundary, and you get approval from your local commissioners on that, and they'd set up that whole process. For private ownership, we do this by way of a shore erosion control lien, which is just a lien placed on the property until the loan is paid back in full. And it's also important to note, on private properties, there is a cash match requirement. There's a formula that goes into that and will generate you a number which would be paid out to the contractor first. Payments are made on for in-place completed work, and so the loan repayments are due annually in September, and there is also an admin fee associated with the project, which goes to the department for project management, invoicing, just general administrative duties, because we've got to take these projects to the Board of Public Works to get approval and things of that nature. So as I mentioned before, yeah, site visits required, and look forward to talking to folks at the breakout room. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for going through those. Lots of great detail. I even learned a few things, and I've been doing grants at DNR for 23 years, so there's always something new to learn. So this was really useful, and we're going to get into a little more detail just here in a minute. I just want to wrap up by going through the application process again. I know everybody touched on it, but this is a really important slide just to kind of get your head around how you should be planning out your process. And I do understand we are kind of halfway through this already. So, hopefully most folks have already started to pull a lot of this together, but never fear, there is still plenty of time. As was mentioned in the beginning of the webinar, July is our time frame for when we open the RFP, and folks, typically at that point, that's when you start filling out that application process. So if you've been through it before, there's a series of questions you go through. Some are applicable to certain outcomes and some are not, and those will get into a little bit more detail. But really what you need to have is that project scope and your budget. and your project timeline really kind of nailed down. And then what we encourage folks to do, and I saw some questions pop up, you know, in the chat about this, talking about what kind of assistance can we provide to you during this open RFP process. And we really encourage for most of the outcomes to do site visits. I know, I do remember, I think Dana touched on it a little bit, but you know, this is where our staff comes out and looks at certain project sites. If you're doing a large restoration or implementation project, or you know, one of the waterway improvement projects or Wes's projects. So site visits, the earlier in your process you can get that done and get questions answered, we really encourage that. We are also always available for a phone meeting or just a meeting in general. And we'll talk a little bit more about office hours in a minute. And then we also have something called Field Doc. Again, if you're familiar with our Outcome 1 and other outcomes that use Field Doc to calculate nutrient reductions for your projects, that assistance is available as well, because that can be a little overwhelming the first time you use it. But Ari, who spoke earlier, and others are here to help with that as well. So that's really, that process is coincides with putting your application together. Again, you can do a lot of this at any point during the year. You know, if you have a project gearing up into July that you know you're going to apply for when the RFP opens and you need help, we'll certainly try to make ourselves available. However, this is the time frame that we know folks are going to be reaching out. And then, you know, this latter part of the open process, we really want to make sure that as you get into November and the December deadline, you're making sure that everything, you have everything buttoned up. You know, do you have partner organization support? Are you partnering with NGOs or local governments? Do you have those letters of supports from communities? Do you have landowner agreements? That's a big one. You know, if we're coming on people's property, we really want to see that they're letting us, that they're going to allow this project to occur if it's adjacent to their property. You know, and that's more relevant in some of the outcomes than others. And again, each specific outcome may have something a little more specific tailored to their needs. They can go into more detail about that in just a moment, but you know, overall, think of this time frame as really our, you know, we're here to help you put together the best application, the strongest application. That's what we want to see. So please do not hesitate to reach out. If you can move to the next slide, please. Yeah, and speaking of reaching out, we can just pop on over to the next slide. We will provide you know, office hours. So there will be links to office hours, but if you want to take a quick look and just see, you know, which outcome you're interested in, and if you want to remember the name of the contact associated with that outcome, I'll give everybody a moment to just either screenshot that or whatever, take a quick look, jot it down, and we can, again, we'll share all of this